Good morning, students. In today's class, I will be starting off with module 4, part 1. So part, there are two parts in that. The first part is about the stability analysis, and the second part is on the root locus. So in today's class, I will be starting off with the first part of module 4, that is is given the transfer form, given the characteristic, we decide whether the given system is stable or not. Okay, this is what you study in this particular module. So for that, we have something called as the Ruth-Hurwitz stability criterion, which you have to follow. That will be studying in the further topics when it comes. So let's start off with stability analysis. Before we go to stability analysis, first we have to know like what is the meaning of a system being stable. So when I say a system is stable, it means that any changes in the input should not cause drastic changes in the output. Then we say the system is stable. Or in other words, we can say stability in the system indicates that the small changes in the input do not result in large changes in the output. So I repeat again, stability in the system indicates that small changes in the input do not result in large changes in the output. So there can be changes in the output, but for any input we give, any finite input we give, we should be able to get some finite output. That is the meaning of a system to be stable. Now coming on to an LTI system. When do we say an LTI system is stable? You have already studied about the LTI system. LTI stands for linear time invariant system. So, LTI system is said to be stable if it satisfies the following conditions. So, the first condition is for a bounded input, the output should be bounded. So, it means that if the input is a finite signal, then the output also should be a finite signal. The second condition is that in the absence of input, the output of the system should tend to zero, irrespective of the initial conditions. So it means that if you have a system, if you're not giving any input, the output also should be equal to zero. So this type of stability, we call it as zero input stability. So as we had already discussed in the previous module, I was telling you about the poles and the zeros. So before we go to that, let me just brief you about the overall transfer function. So if I consider the transfer function of a single input, single output system, when I say single input, we are giving some single input R of S, we are getting a single output C of S. So that is the meaning of single input, single output system. So the transfer function of a single input, single output system, overall transfer function is given by G of S by 1 plus G of S into H of S. So if I equate the numerator polynomial to 0, I will get the location of zeros. And at the same time, if I equate the denominator polynomial to 0, I get the location of poles. So the denominator polynomial equated to 0 is also called as the characteristic equation. So why do we call it as the characteristic equation? Because the roots of the denominator polynomial will decide, the roots are nothing but the poles. The roots will decide the characteristics of the time response. So that is the reason we call the denominator polynomial equated to zero as the characteristic equation. Repeat again, the numerator polynomial will give you the roots of the numerator polynomial will give you the location of zeros, and the roots of the denominator polynomial, that is the characteristic equation, will give you the location of the poles. Now, this equation can also be represented in this form, b0 s to the power of m plus b1 s to the power of m minus 1 plus dash dash bm. Similarly, the denominator a0 s to the power of n plus a1 s to the power of n minus 1 plus dash dash an. So, as I said you here, the roots of the numerator of the transfer function will give you the location of zeros, and the roots of the denominator will give you the location of poles. Now, what are the zeros and poles? So, what do you mean by zeros? So, zeros, the value of S that will make the transfer function zero is called as zeros. So, if you see this equation here, so when will the transfer function, that is C of S by R of S, become equal to zero? So, it becomes zero when the numerator, when the value of S for which the transfer function will become zero. So, the transfer function will become zero only when G of S will become equal to zero. So now, so this is the meaning. So the value of S for which the transfer function becomes zero, we call it as zeros, and the value of S for which the transfer function will become infinity. So when will C of S by R of S become equal to infinity? When the denominator will become equal to zero. So that we call it as something divided by zero is infinity. So that is the one what we call it as poles. So the value of S that makes the transfer function zero is called as zeros, and the value of S that makes the transfer function infinite are called as poles. So now, if you equate the numerator polynomial to zero, you get the location of zeros. If you equate the denominator polynomial to zero, we get the location of poles. And among the poles and zeros, the one that is very important is the location of poles or the poles, because the location of poles will decide about the stability of the system. So now we will see like what is the effect of the location of poles on the stability. How the location of poles will decide whether the given system is stable or unstable. Continuing further, so as I said you, the denominator polynomial. So which is the denominator polynomial of the overall transfer function? That is 1 plus g of s h of s equated to 0, we call it as the characteristic equation, the roots of which is nothing but the poles. So the characteristic equation is given by 1 plus g of s h of s equal to 0. The location of the poles will decide the stability of the system. So if you are able to find the poles using this equation, then depending on the poles, we can tell whether depending on the location, we can tell whether the system is stable or unstable. So this is a very important thing what we are supposed to remember here. So for any given transfer function, so when we equate the denominator polynomial to zero and try to find the location of the roots, which are nothing but the poles, then we see that for a given transfer function, the poles will either lie on the LHS of the S plane, or on the RHS of the S plane, or on the imaginary axis, or at the origin. So this is your S plane. When I say S plane, it means S is equal to sigma plus j omega. So this is your S plane. So where sigma is the real axis, j omega is the imaginary axis. So when we find the poles by using the characteristic equation, these are the only possible cases. So the poles can either lie on the right hand side of the S plane, or it can lie on the left-hand side of the S plane, or it can lie on the imaginary axis, or it can lie at the origin. So these are the only four possible cases where the poles can lie. But this is very important what you are supposed to remember. For any system to be stable, the condition that has to be satisfied is all the poles should lie on the LHS of the S plane. So when you find the poles, after finding the poles, when you sketch, if you see that all the poles are lying on the LHS of the S plane, then we say that the system is stable. Otherwise, even if you have all the poles on the left hand side and just one pole on the right hand side, then the system becomes unstable. So this is a necessary condition what you are supposed to remember. For a system to be stable, all the poles should lie only on the left hand side of the. So this is a very important condition what you are supposed to remember. So now we'll take the location of the poles one by one and see whether the given system is stable or unstable. Are you able to hear me? Is my voice audible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Is my voice audible? Okay, let's take the first condition now. Single pole, the first condition is single pole on the RHS of the S plane. So when I say single pole on the RHS of the S plane, I have assumed that the pole is a real pole. So you can have imaginary poles also. To that condition will come later. So now I have considered a single real pole on the RHS of the S plane. So if I evaluate the denominator polynomial to 0, and if I am getting a pole to be s is equal to minus 1, minus 2. So s is equal to minus 2, it means that, so when I sketch it in the S plane, you can see that s is equal to minus 2 is here. So always remember, poles are represented by cross marks and zeros are represented by a zero. But since we are not concentrating much on the zeros, I am showing you only the poles. So always remember, this is the notation what you are supposed to remember. Poles are always represented using a cross mark or into mark. So s is equal to minus 2. So now s is equal to minus 2. I have a real pole at s is equal to minus 2. So where is this pole? This pole is on the left hand side of the S plane. So we say that the system is stable. So similarly, coming to the second stage, second condition. Single pole, single real pole on the RHS of the S plane. So after you find the pole, if you are having a pole on the right hand side of the S plane, for example, S is equal to minus 3, S is equal to plus 3. So when I sketch this, you can see S is equal to 3, you have a pole here. So since this is on the right hand side, we say that the system is unstable. So these conditions you have to remember. Similarly, let's go to the next one. If you have a single pole at the origin, what if you have a single pole at the origin? So single pole at the origin means s is equal to 0. I have one single pole at the origin. So if you have a single pole at the origin, then the comment is that the system is marginally stable. So marginally stable means that it is completely not stable or completely not unstable. It is between stable and unstable. So we call it as marginally stable. So because we know that for the system to be stable, poles should lie on the LHS of the S plane. For the system to be unstable, poles will lie on the RHS of the S plane. If you have a single pole or in between those two, then we say that it is marginally stable. Now let's go to the next condition. What if you have double poles at the origin? Now, instead, in the previous case, we saw we had a single pole at the origin and we came to the conclusion that it is marginally stable. But at the same time, if you have double poles at the origin, so s is equal to 0, 0, you have two poles at the origin. So I just overlapped this and everything so that you can understand that you have double poles at the same location, origin. So whenever you have such a case, then we come to a conclusion that the system is stable. If you have one pole, it is marginally stable. If you have two poles, then the system will become unstable. So this you have to remember. Let's move on to the next one. One pair of complex poles on the LHS of the S plane. So now you have one pair of complex poles. So I've just taken an example as minus 2 plus j1, minus 2 minus j1. So we know that complex poles will always occur in pairs. So you can see here minus 2 plus j1. I'll sketch that and I marked the two poles. Now, since both the poles are lying on the left hand side of the S plane, the system is stable. The next condition, one pair of complex poles on the right hand side of the S plane. So I've taken an example, 2 plus j1, 2 minus j1. So when you sketch, 2 is the real axis plus j1 minus j1, imaginary axis. Just see where you get those points, mark those points. So now you have the two poles on the right hand side of the S plane. Therefore, the system is unstable. One pair of imaginary poles. The next condition is you have one pair of imaginary poles. So you don't have the real part here, you just have only imaginary poles. I have taken the condition S is equal to plus or minus J1. So plus J1, minus J1, you have one pair of imaginary poles on the imaginary axis. So what happens when you come across such a case? You see that the system is marginally stable. Okay, so you have to remember this. It is not on the left hand side, it is not on the right hand side. So the system will be marginally stable. Like your pole at the origin, you had a single pole at the origin, you came to the conclusion that it is marginally stable. What you have, double pair of repeated imaginary poles. So if I have double poles at the same location on the imaginary axis, so what is the next condition? So you can see here, double pair of repeated imaginary poles. So at place J1 minus J1, I have two poles here, plus J1 minus J1 plus J1 minus J1. So I have double pair of repeated poles. So in that case, we say that the system is unstable. So just you have to remember the one what we did for the origin. So we in the previous case, when you see, we considered single, if you had a single pole at the origin, it is marginally stable. Similarly, the same thing, if you have double poles at the origin, it becomes unstable. Similarly, for the imaginary axis also, you can see if you have one pair of poles on the imaginary axis, then it is marginally stable. If you have double pair of repeated imaginary poles, then the system will become unstable. The next condition is, what if you have double pair of non-repeated imaginary poles? You have two pairs of poles on the imaginary axis, but what if it is at two different locations? So plus J1, minus J1, plus J2, minus J2. You have four poles on the imaginary axis. So in that case, we come to a conclusion that it is marginally stable. So if you are able to remember all these conditions, these nine conditions, then you can very easily determine whether the given system is stable or unstable. So just this is a very important note which you are supposed to remember, which I also repeated it earlier also. Even if there is a single pole on the right hand side of the S plane, then the system becomes unstable. Okay, so if you have two poles on the left hand side and one pole on the right hand side, then the system becomes unstable. If you have two poles on the left hand side and one pole on at the imaginary axis, it becomes marginally stable. If you have two poles on the left hand side, two poles at the origin, then it becomes unstable. So like this, if you are able to remember the all the nine conditions what I said you earlier, then you can solve any problem that it is given to you. Now let's move on to the types of stability. So before we go to the types of stability, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Am I going fast?
No, ma'am.
So, absolute stability. A system is said to be absolutely stable if all the poles will lie on the LHS of the S plane. So the condition for stability, what I said you earlier, if all the poles are lying on the LHS of the S plane, then we say that the system is absolutely stable. Okay. The next one is critically or marginally stable. So we can say a system is marginally stable or critically stable if the poles will lie on the J omega axis and they are not repeated. So if you have one pair of poles, imaginary poles on the imaginary axis, then we say that the system is marginally or critically stable. The last one is relatively stable. So a system is said to be relatively stable if the poles are located far away from the j omega axis in the LHS plane. So it means that the poles are in the LHS plane, but they are very much far away from the j omega axis. So then we say that it is relatively stable. But in your syllabus, what we are studying is we are identifying whether the system is stable, unstable, or marginally stable. So just remember these three points. For a system to be stable, all the poles should lie on the LHS of the S plane. For the system to be unstable, even if you have one pole on the RHS, the system becomes unstable. And for marginally stable, you should have at least one pair of poles on the imaginary axis, which is not repeated. Now, the transfer function for a closed loop system. So this is the transfer function equation which we saw in the beginning. C of s by R of s, which is G of s by 1 plus G of s H of s, is given by this equation. So I have written the equation here. The overall transfer function G of s by 1 plus G of s H of s. The denominator polynomial is nothing but the characteristic equation. So the denominator polynomial is the characteristic equation equated to 0. That is 1 plus G of s H of s equated to 0. Now, to equate this to 0, it means that this equation equated to 0. So that is what I have written. A naught s to the power of n, a1 s to the power of n minus 1 dash dash plus an is equal to 0. So now, once you have the characteristic equation, as I said you earlier also, if you know the characteristic equation, you can decide whether the system is stable or unstable. If it has only two poles or something like that, then very easily you can decide, find the poles and find. But there are some either, but there will be characteristic equations which will have 5 or 6 poles or 10 poles. In that case, you cannot directly find the poles very easily. So in order to find the location of the poles, we go in for something called as the root array table. So the root array table is prepared using the characteristic equation what we have. The characteristic equation is this what we have. Now, how to prepare the root array table, I'll tell you. So all of you pay attention here. See, now if you know the characteristic equation, by using the coefficients of the characteristic equation, you can prepare the first two rows of the root array table. For example, if I have the characteristic equation which has the highest degree n, you can see here s to the power of n, s to the power of n minus 1, s to the power of n minus 2, n minus 3, and this will be s to the power of 0. Okay, so now first I should prepare the table in this way. I should first write all the s to the power of n terms on the left hand side in this way, like this. S to the power of n, s power n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, and I have to go till s to the power of 1, s to the power of 0. But now, we cannot get the table, complete table, at one stretch. You have to do some calculations over there. Now, how to do the calculations? So, using the coefficients of the characteristic equation, you can find the first two rows of the table. Like, how do you write the coefficients? See, the coefficients are a0, a1, a2, a3, and it goes up to a. So how do we write the coefficients? It is like this. How you do? Don't write it one line. Write it one below the other. A0, a1, a2, a3, a4, a5, a6, a7. Then an minus 1, an minus 2, and then finally you get an. So this is how you write. So one above, one below. One above, one below. One above, one below. So like this, you have to write the first two rows of the table. Okay. So after you, and one more thing you have to remember. When the characteristic equation is given to you, sometimes some of the coefficients will not be mentioned. For example, if you have the coefficient as a to the power of s to the power of n, plus a2 s to the power of n minus 1, n minus 2, n minus 3, and so on, it means that this term is not there. First step, what you have to observe here is you have to see whether there are all the powers of s. starting from the highest degree to the lowest degree, 0. So from s, for example, if n is equal to 4, I should check whether s to the power of 4 is there, s power 3 is there, s power 2 is there, s power 1, s power 0 is there. If any of the element is missing, then that particular coefficient we take it as 0. For example, if the second term is not there here, so it means that a1 is 0. So you should not skip this a1 and just write a0 here, a2 here. This a0, it will be 0 here, a2, a3, and so on. So always remember, the coefficients what you have here are nothing but the coefficients of the characteristic equation. So how do you write it? One below the other. One in the first row, one in the second row. One in the first row, one in the second row. So you have to come, go up, down, up, down. So you have to write it like this. A0, A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. So till you complete all the elements of the characteristic equation. So after you get the first two rows, how do we get the second two rows? The second, the next row. The next row is about s to the power of n minus 2. How do we find b0, b1, b2 and so on? So the other elements are not written because you may have a term there or it might be a zero. So just to explain you, like how do we find this b0? This element b0 is found using the coefficients of the previous two rows. How do we find b0? I'll tell you, just observe here, this a1 into a2 minus a0 into a3 divided by a1. Okay, I'll repeat it again. B0 is a1, a2 minus a0, a3 whole divided by a1. I've written the equation also here. I've written the equation here. You can just see this a1, a2 minus a0, a3 by a1. So similarly, the next term is b1. So b1, how do we find? So students make mistake, they write it like this: a3, a4 minus a2, a5 divided by a3. No, it is not so. So you have to be very careful here. B1 is given by a1 into a4 minus a1. So b1 is what? A1, a4, a0, a5 divided by a1. So for b1, I've shown that in dotted lines. For b0, I've shown in solid line. Similarly, you have to find b2 means what you're supposed to do. So b2 will be a1 into a6 minus a0 into a7 divided by a1. So similarly, you have to find the other elements till you arrive at a 0. Coming to the next one. After we have found the next row, coming to the next one, C0. How we find C0? C0 is found using the previous two rows. Previous two rows means s to the power of n minus 1 row and s to the power of n minus 2 row. So how do you find C0? C0 is B0 into A3, B0 into A3 minus A1 into B1 divided by B0. I'll repeat again, C0 is B0 into A3 minus A1 into B1 divided by B0. C1 is B0 into A5 minus A1 into B2 divided by B0. C2 will be equal to B0 into A7 minus A1 into, if nothing is there, it is 0, divided by B0. So like this, we have to complete the table till we arrive at the last row of the root array table. So this is how you prepare the root array table. So once you have prepared the root array table, then by looking into the elements of the first column of the root array table. So when I say first column of the root array table, it is this column what we are actually interested in. This is the first column what we are speaking. So by looking into the elements of the first column, we can say whether the system is stable or unstable. So that is the only thing what we can say by looking into the elements. So this can be said only after we complete the entire table. So I've just given the equations here to how to calculate the different rows. Similarly, when we put, so I've just mentioned here, the procedure is repeated till we arrive and calculate the elements of the last row. Okay, so now keeping this in mind, so now we know like how to prepare the root array table. So since we know how to prepare the root array table, let's move on and see what is the condition. So from the root array table, how do we say whether the system is stable or unstable? Students, are you there? Are you there? Hello? Can you hear
me? Yes, ma'am.
So I'll just start off with this. I'll just tell you what is the root array table and one simple problem, then I'll stop for today's class. Okay. So the root stability criterion, or it is also called as the Root-Hurwitz stability criterion. So what does the criterion say? It states that for a system to be stable, it is necessary and sufficient that all the elements of the first column of the root array table is positive and non-zero. So the condition is that for a system to be stable, according to Root-Hurwitz stability criterion, it is necessary and sufficient that all the elements of the first column of the root array table is positive and non-zero. So it means that it should be either a positive number or it should be it should not be a zero element there. If all the elements of the, now after you have prepared the table, then what is the conclusion you come to? If all the elements of the first column of the root array table, so when I say first column of the root array, I am speaking of this a0, a1, b0, c0, m0, k0, l0. So these are the elements of the first column. So if all the elements of the first column are positive, they have some positive value and it is non-zero, then it indicates that all the poles will lie on the left-hand side of the S-plane and the system is stable. So I repeat, if all the elements of the first column of the root array table is positive and non-zero, then it indicates that all the poles will lie on the LHS of the S-plane and the system is stable. So this is the first thing. Now, coming to the second case. If some of the elements, what if some of the elements of the first column of the root array table is negative? Some elements are negative. So we have come to the second case where we have both positive and negative elements there in the first column. Then what does it indicate? It indicates that the number of sign changes, the number of sign changes, I'll tell you what is a sign change. The number of sign changes will indicate the number of poles that will lie on the RHS of the S-plane and the system is considered to be unstable. So whenever you come across a condition wherein if you at least have one negative element in the first column, then we come to the conclusion that the system is unstable. So when I say unstable, it means that some poles will lie on the right hand side. So how many poles will lie on the right hand side? The number of sign changes will tell you how many poles will lie on the RHS of the S-plane. So this is what we are actually supposed to remember. So the two conditions is, if all the elements of the first column of the root array is positive, the system is stable and all the poles will lie on the LHS of the S-plane. At the same time, if some elements of the first column, some elements is negative, then we say that the number of sign changes will indicate how many poles are lying on the right hand side of the S-plane and the system is unstable. I'll just take one simple problem to tell you how to calculate the the roots are a table. So this is a problem. I'll just take this problem. I'll finish this problem and I'll stop it for today. In the next class, I'll take up the sign changes problem. A closed loop control system has a characteristic equation given below. Comment on the stability using the Ruth-Hurwitz criterion. So the criterion is the characteristic equation is given by this equation. So this is the denominator polynomial of your overall transfer function, characteristic equation. So now, the first step, we have to prepare the root array table. Now, by looking into the poles here, now, this is an equation of order 3. This is a system of order 3 because the highest degree of the denominator polynomial or the characteristic equation is 3. So the degree is 3. Do not get confused with degree, I'm sorry, do not get confused with the order of the system and type of the system. I repeat again, the order of the system is determined by the highest degree of the denominator polynomial or the characteristic equation of the overall transfer function. And when I say the type of the system, type represents how many poles you have at the origin. If it's a type 2 system, it means the system has two poles at the origin. So type 2 is different and order 2 is different. Okay. Now going back to this one. So s to the power of 3. So since the order is 3, it means that there are 3 poles in this particular problem. So how many poles we have? The order will represent how many poles are there. So since it is s cubed, there are 3 poles in this. Now let us construct this array table. What are the coefficients of this? Let first thing you have to check whether you have all the coefficients or not. We have s cubed, s squared, s power 1, s to the power of 0. Since all the elements are there, now quickly we'll prepare the first two rows of the table. So let's start with, since it is starting with s cube, so s cube, s square, s1, s to the power of 0. So like this you have to prepare the table. Now, what are the coefficients? 1, 4.5, 3.5, 1.5. So just write one below the other. 1, 4.5, 3.5, 1.5. One in the first row, one in the second row, one in the first row, one in the second row. So I repeat again, 1, 4.5, 3.5, 1.5. See the cursor? 1, 4.5, 3.5, 1.5. So after you have done this, all the coefficients you have considered. Now you have to find the first element of s to the power of 1. So how do we find this 3.16 is 4.5 multiplied with 3.5 minus 1 into 1.5 divided by 4.5. So you have done the calculation here. You can see 4.5 into 3.5 minus 1 into 1.5 divided by 4.5. I get it as 3.16. So 3.16. The next element, how do I get? 4.5 into 0 minus 1 into 0 divided by 4.5. So it is 0 minus 0 by 4.5. So it is 0. So I have mentioned 0 here. You have a zero if you want, you can write. Otherwise, you can ignore. It's not an issue. Going to the last one. 3.16 into 1.5 minus 4.5 into 0 divided by 3.16. You get it as 1.5. So you can see it. 3.16 into 1.5 minus 4.5 into 0 is 0. So it is 3.16 into 1.5 minus 0 divided by 3.16. So 3.16, 3.16 will get cancelled and you are left with 1.5. So after you have prepared the table, now you have to observe the elements of the first column. So when you observe the elements of the first column, you see that all the elements what you have here, they are positive. Since all the elements are positive, the elements of the first column of the Ruth array table are positive and non-zero, we say that the system is stable. So when we say the system is stable, it means that we are not, in this problem, we are not finding where we have the poles. Just by looking into the sign, we are able to identify whether the system is stable or unstable. But where they lie, that we are not finding. So among the three poles what you have, since all the elements are positive, all the three poles will lie on the left-hand side of the S-plane and we come to the conclusion that the system is stable. You can see, since all the elements of the first column are positive and non-zero, all the three poles lie on the LHS of the S plane and the system is stable. So this is the first condition what I was talking about, the first one. So in the next class, let's look into the second condition and we shall solve some more problems based on that. So with this, I come to the end of today's class, and once I complete the notes, I'll be sharing you the material. Since my notes are all held up in the college, I'm preparing the notes again. So it will take some time for me. So by the end of this week, I will share the material to you. So have a nice day. Stay home, stay safe, and please don't forget whatever I've said today. Tomorrow, I'll be having the class in the fourth term. So bye for today. Have a nice day.